Hello, I'm Simon Whistler. You're watching Today I Found Out, and in the video today, why is X generally the unknown in mathematics? And just before we get started, I do want to say that this video is brought to you by Dollar Shave Club. Get your first month for just $5, which includes an executive razor plus some shave butter, by going to dollarshaveclub.com/brainfood. You'll find a link in the description below. So for hundreds of years, X has been the go-to symbol for the unknown quantity in mathematical equations. So the question today is, who started this practice? Algebra was born out of the Middle East during the golden age of medieval Islamic civilization from 750 to 1258 AD, and its early form can be seen in the work of Muhammad Al-Khwarizmi. This can be found in a book he wrote in the 9th century. During this heyday, Muslim rule and culture had expanded into the Iberian Peninsula, where the Moors encouraged scholarship in the sciences and math. So, well, what does this have to do with the letter X in math? In a recent TED talk, the director of the Radius Foundation, Terry Moore, posited that the use of X in this way began with an inability of the Spanish scholars to translate certain Arabic sounds, including the letter sheen or shin. According to Moore, the word for unknown thing in Arabic is al-shalan, and it appeared many times in early mathematical works. For example, you might see 3 unknown things equals 15, with the unknown thing then being 5. But since Spanish scholars had no corresponding sounds for sh, they went with the k sound, which in classical Greek is written with the chi symbol x. Moore hypothesizes, as many others before him have done, that when this was later translated into Latin, the chi x was replaced with the more common Latin x. This is similar to how Xmas, meaning Christmas, came about from the common practice of religious scholars using the Greek letter chi, x, as shorthand for Christ. The problem with Moore's explanation is that there is no direct documented evidence to support it. More speculatively, people translating the works would not care about phonetics, but the meaning of the words. So whether they had a sh or not, one would think it would be irrelevant. Despite the lack of direct evidence and flaws in the argument, it nonetheless remains a very popular origin theory, even among many academics. If you do a quick Google search of this, you'll find many a PhD in mathematics parroting this same theory. Now, according to the 1909 to 1916 edition of Webster's Dictionary, among others, they also put forward a similar theory, although stating that the Arabic word for the singular thing, shy, was translated into the Greek zai and later shortened to x. Dr. Ali Kounseri also notes that the Greek word for unknown, xenos, also begins with x, and the convention could simply have been born of an abbreviation. But here, again, we have a lack of any direct documented evidence to support these theories. As for a documented theory, we turn to the great philosopher and mathematician René Descartes. It's entirely possible Descartes did not come up with the practice of using X for an unknown, perhaps borrowing it from someone else, but at least as far as documented evidence that has survived to today goes, he seems to be the creator of the practice. This is noted by the OED and the phenomenal 1929 work by Florian Cajori, A History of Mathematical Notations. At the least, Descartes helped popularize the practice. Specifically, in his landmark 1637 work, La Geometrie, Descartes solidifies the movement to symbolic notation by instituting the convention of using the lowercase letters at the beginning of the alphabet for known quantities, for example, A, B, and C, and using those at the end of the alphabet for unknown quantities, for example, Z, Y, and X. So why did he do this, and why did he use X more than Y and Z for the unknowns? Well, nobody knows for sure, but it has been speculated that the prominence of X being used more than Y and Z for unknowns in this work had to do with typesetting. One story goes that it was Descartes' printer who suggested X be the principal unknown in La Geometrie because it was the letter least used, and so the one he had more letter blocks available to use. Whether this is true or not, Descartes used the X to be an unknown, at least as early as 1629 in various manuscripts. This was actually well before the publication of La Geometrie. And indeed, it would seem that he had not come to any hard rules on X, Y, and Z indicating unknowns in some manuscripts from this time. He actually used X, Y, and Z to represent known quantities, casting even further doubt on the supposed unknown thing translation theories previously mentioned. So in the end, as far as hard documented evidence shows, it appears Descartes arbitrarily chose these letters to represent different things in his works, as was convenient, and it just so happened in his landmark work, La Geometrie, he decided the specific variable nomenclature, perhaps on a whim. Whatever the case, as with Descartes' notation for powers, after the publication of La Geometrie, the use of X as a principal unknown, as well as the more general tradition of A, B, and C being knowns and X, Y, and Z being unknowns, gradually caught on. And the rest? as they say, is mathematical history. So I really hope you're enjoying this video so far. And just before we get into the bonus facts, I do want to talk about Dollar Shave Club very quickly. Now, this shiny head doesn't stay shiny and hair-free on its own. Well, I mean, the top part definitely does, but that's just because I'm not bald by choice. But round the sides and on top to get rid of the stray hairs, I gotta shave it up there. Now, it's important to note that I do not shave here in the studio. No surprise there. So let's go home.
Magic of television. Okay, so here I am at home. First of all, let me apologize for this terrible lighting. All I have is these, like, above-head super bright halogen bulbs, which cast terrible shadows. I have to say, I never thought I'd be the guy doing the razor advertisements. To me, they always look like, well, magic of television again, like this dude. But Dollar Shave Club, they send out one of these. This never focuses when I try to bring it in because it just wants to focus on my face, but I'll show some better images of this right now. But look at this beautiful thing. I've had this for like 6 months now. Every month they send me a box of razors, like super razor sharp razors. I use razor as a analogy for razor. It's got like a cool little logo on there. I'm just gonna give up with the focusing thing. But this goes on here. Let's see how this works. They also sell this stuff, this shave butter. I decided to go for this. I just squirt out like a tiny little amount and just rub it on my bald head. I'm not shaving my beard off. I think I mentioned that last time because, you know, when Dollar Shave Club approached me for a sponsorship, I was like, you know, I got a big beard, right? And then I realized I got a large other part of my head to shave. I really need to look in the mirror, actually. Otherwise, I'm going to cut myself badly. Look at that, just one swipe, and no horrible bloody cuts that you get from cheaper razors. There's six blades on there. There's one on the back for those little precision spots, so I tend to do that there, and then also here, because if I don't shave here, I get hair all over my face. I'm like a wolf man.
I also have a little go down here, because, you know, no one likes a neck beard.
That's it, Dollar Shave Club. Let's go back to the studio, magic television.
So, as I said to you in that clip, you can get your first month of Dollar Shave Club for just $5. That includes an executive razor plus a tube of shave butter. Razors are then delivered every month to your door for just a few dollars. You can get on board with Dollar Shave Club by going to dollarshaveclub.com/brainfood, first month for $5, and doing that also helps support the show. And now, let's get in to those bonus facts. The equal sign was invented in 1557 by Welsh mathematician Robert Record. He was fed up with writing is equal to in his equations. He chose the two lines because, to quote, no two things can be more equal. And now for another bonus fact. The mathematical volume of pizza is actually pizza. So how does that work? Well, if z is the radius of the pizza and a is the height, then what you do is pi, pi, by z, by a, which of course equals pizza. And now for another bonus fact. As mentioned, La Geometrie was a groundbreaking work. In it, Descartes introduced the idea that eventually became known as Cartesian coordinates. This included the idea of two perpendicular lines called axes, naming the horizontal one x and the vertical axis y, and also designating the point of intersection as the origin. Descartes is also credited with one of the most famous lines in all of Western thought, cogito ergo sum, I think, therefore I am. That said, while Descartes is famous for the notion, I think, therefore I am, he was not the first to express such an idea. For example, Aristotle said something similar. But if life is good and pleasant, and if one who sees is conscious that he sees, one who hears that he hears, one who walks that he walks, and similarly for all the other human activities, there is a faculty that is conscious of their exercise, so that whenever we perceive, we are conscious that we perceive, and whenever we think, we are conscious that we think, and to be conscious that we are perceiving or thinking is to be conscious that we exist. Of course, I think therefore I am is a lot more succinct, so doubtless contributed to it being more remembered than Aristotle's version. And now for another bonus fact. The Program for International Student Assessment, PISA, assesses the competencies of 15-year-olds in 65 countries and economies, including in math. For 2012, the country economy with the highest score in math was Shanghai, China, which was closely followed by Singapore, Hong Kong, Chinese Taipei, and Korea. Notably, Canada ranked 13, Australia 19th, Ireland 20th, and the United Kingdom 26th. The United States' kids ranked 36th. In fact, according to PISA, the performance of one of the US's highest scoring states, Massachusetts, was so low it was as if those students had two fewer years of mathematical education than the students in Shanghai, China. PISA also noted that although the US spends more per student than most other countries, this doesn't translate into performance. In 2012, per student spending in the US was listed at $115,000, while in the Slovak Republic, a country that performed at the same level, they only spend $53,000 per student. It should be noted of the PISA's results, though, that they are drastically oversimplified. For instance, as noted in a report by Dr. Martin Carnoy of Stanford and Richard Rothstein of the Economic Policy Institute, American students actually perform better than the much higher-ranked Finland in algebra in general, but worse in fractions. Further, when you normalize the results between the countries, adjusting for the relative poverty of the students taking the PISA tests, the US performs significantly better, ranking 6th in reading and 13th in mathematics, a huge jump in both categories. They further note in their report, called What Do International Tests Really Show About U.S. Student Performance, that when you divide the kids based on family wealth, the actual gap in performance isn't very big between countries, with a not insignificant portion of the ultimate ranking of each nation being based on how many impoverished versus middle class versus wealthy students are taking the test. For reference, about 40% of the schools the PISA used in the U.S.'s sample had more than 50% of their students eligible for free lunch. So, I really hope you found that video interesting. As I mentioned earlier, please do check out our sponsored Dollar Shave Club to get started today. Find a link in the description below. And as always, thank you for watching.